Thank you so much, Dr. Dimler, for this nice introduction. And I want also to thank Avenir Suisse for organizing this timely think tank summit. I'm glad that I can participate in this conference. So I was asked to speak more on this geopolitical dimensions, and the topic is geopolitics and institutions. Unfortunately, my PowerPoint is not visible, so I have to always to ask for the next slide. So the next slide, please. Thank you. We live in a polarized world. We can hear it every day in the media, whether it's US-China, US-Russia, as we see today. But looking at the academic concepts, after the end of the Cold War, they already developed some ideas how the future world might develop. So coming back to our title, if I put title of our theme of the conference in context, so I use the context polarity. Polarity can be addressed in two ways. It can be exacerbated. Usually geopolitics is the one who exacerbate polarity, but there are also concepts out which can mitigate the polarization. And here I look mainly on institutions, but that's mainly at the end of my presentation. Polarity comes in different shades, formats, in different periods, and we are all familiar with the bipolarity during the Cold War when we had the Cold War alliances. Since we are in Switzerland and I'm coming from Austria, I would also want to mention the neutrals. The neutral states were not a part of the bloc system, so they were the anomaly, they were the exception. They managed to stay out directly from the great power conflict. Nevertheless, neutrals played a useful role in mitigating, mediation, and especially during the CAC process. After bipolarity, we had this idea coming up, unipolarity, and the academic concept, which is based on this unipolarity, or let's say assumed unipolarity, was the unipolar moment by Charles Krauthammer. Many expected that NATO would demise as the Warsaw Pact Treaty Organization did. NATO survived. Here is not a place to discuss why. There have been several explanations why NATO stayed on. However, it was the one Cold War alliances which survived the end of the Cold War. Another academic concept which is somehow linked to unipolarity is the idea of the hegemonic peace. So it's a realist concept that would say if one hegemonic power dominates the world, it will be a peaceful world because no other power would dare to challenge the hegemon. However, looking back to our unipolar moment, it was not a peaceful period at all. So we had, just to mention a few examples, the Kuwait War and the Balkan Wars, the Afghanistan War started, the Iraq War started. So it was not peaceful. The hegemonic peace concept has some flaws here. Then also realists came up with the idea of this multipolarity. And looking into history, multipolarity always implied also polarization. And polarization in many ways led to military conflict and armed conflict as well, and war. And we had multipolar worlds before the First World War and before the Second World War. This multipolarity is described with other expressions over the time. Some call it the post-American world, and some call it the rise of the rest. Next slide, please. There are some ideas already which try to look at this polarity in the world and how, and asks how it could end up peacefully and not necessarily end up in military confrontation. So one academic very thought through book is by Charles Kupchan. So he wrote this book about no one's world. So his idea was that we have not poles anymore, but we have a multiplicity of centers in the world, and no one can dominate the world, neither China nor the US nor Russia nor any other emerging power. But the problem with this no one's world was, how do these centers communicate? And Charles Kupchan uses a concept which has been used by others before him. This is the idea of the concept, concert of powers. It goes back to the Vienna Congress, and the Swiss and the Austrians are very familiar what happened there at this Congress. But in political science, the idea is that it has both dimensions. There's the dimension of the balance of power between the victory powers after the Napoleonic Wars, but also the developed common rules and norms in order to avoid great power conflict among them. There are two flaws with this idea, of course. Small states are sidelined in this concept, so they are not really addressed. And the second is, the great powers did not limit the use of force in their colonies and outside of Europe. And there have been many wars fought outside of Europe. Even so, the concept of power worked basically for one century. So it worked on the half of the 19th century until the Crimean War and the wars of unification in Europe. But more or less, then it lasted again after this war until the onset of the First World War. This concept of powers has been used by Charles Kupchan, but the original idea actually came from Franklin Roosevelt. So he had this idea in 1945. Henry Kissinger in 75 claimed that it was his idea when he designed this concept of five big powers, the pentagonal order, which already sees China, the Soviet Union, the US, and also Europe already as emerging power. But of course, the US should remain in the lead. That was the Kissinger idea. Then the European Union thought, what role do we play? And I just pick out the idea by Giovanni Grevi. He thought the unipolar world is polarizing, that's true, but we also have interdependence. We have poles and interdependence, and then he came up with the idea of the interpolar world in order to find this mitigating element, interdependence. Next slide, please. So if you look at polarization, and especially if you look at the periods we are discussing, polarization always is underpinned by idealists and ideological arguments. So polarization, so as far as I talked about, is mainly a geopolitical development, but of course idealists come in as well. The idealists also claim there is some leading power who defines the values of the world. And we know that from the Cold War that we had this ideological division as well. We had on the one hand this democratic market economies, and on the other side we had communism and the planned economy. So each side had some ideological idealist underpinning as well. In the current debate, these idealist concepts come also in different versions. The democratic hegemony is discussed, for example, by Robert Kagan. So his argument is, yes, we have a democratic hegemony, but it can only work if the US is in the lead. It would disappear if there would be a decline of America. In contrast, John Eikenbury says the American values, he says American values and forgets about the European values. He says that these values are already so strong that they would prevail even if we have an American decline in the future. So it's similar to this idea. This is a popular concept by Francis Fukuyama, the end of history, when he said democracies will prevail in the future, market economy will prevail in the future. So this idealist concepts also use the idea of democratic peace, which is an old concept that goes back to the 70s already, that democracies would not fight democracies. So democracies would not go to war with democracies. So it's a correlation. The causation is not clear yet. So that's we cannot discuss it here. It's a correlation more or less, which works with some exceptions. Also this democratic peace was used for geopolitical reasons. For example, Bill Clinton used it for NATO, for the explanation of NATO enlargement, when he said NATO would bring democracy to these East European states, and then we would have peace there. And also it was used by George W. Bush, and he said, we bring democracy to Iraq, and then we'll spill over to other states, and then we have a democratic Middle East, and that would be a peaceful Middle East. So it's a little bit a shortcut what I'm arguing here, but basically that's in a nutshell what he was saying. So this idealist ideological arguments are always accompany always polarization as well, if you have both. The second feature here is alliance building. In a situation in a polarized world, alliances are flourishing. So we had it, of course, during the Cold War. It's a case in point. And now we have these existing alliances. I talked about NATO, but we also have this smaller collective security treaty organization of the East European states with the leading of Russia. And it had a prominent role right now in the Kazakhstan case, which would be an interesting case to discuss how the CSTO was really applied, even not only for external threat, but also for internal insurgency. But we also have now interest, because that's a signal that we are living in a polarized world. We have new alliances emerging now. We have this new alliance, AUKUS, it's a wrong spelling here, corrected it in my new version. This is a new alliance between Australia, UK and US. We heard about it in the media only because of this submarine treaty which was cancelled with France, but that it's not really the most important thing. The most important thing is that we have a new alliance here. And also a new alliance is emerging in Asia. This is against China and the Quad as well, which includes India and Japan as well, and Australia and the US. And a little bit in disguise come the Abraham Accords. It's basically an anti-Iranian alliance in the Middle East between Israel and some Arab states, even so it's of course also has some elements that dimension, cultural, economic, not only military dimension. The military dimension is not really explicit. It speaks of a strategic alliance. All right, next slide, please. We have heard now almost since Joseph Biden is president, he came up with this alliance of democracies. This is an ideal combination of these two features, the idealist dimension and the alliance dimension. So we have an alliance and we have this democracy dimension against autocracies. What of course Joseph Biden means is China and Russia. However, it has of course an hypocritical aspect as well, because the US is allying also with authoritarian states if geopolitics requires it. So he tries to build up good contacts with communist authoritarian Vietnam, with the Philippines of Duterte, with Saudi Arabia, and with some other states which cannot be called democracies. And interestingly, we have in Europe a similar debate when Joseph Beuys spoke at the NATO summit and said the NATO is an alliance of common values, and the next day the European Union is saying Turkey, Poland and Hungary do not share our values. So you can see here the contradiction here of this concept of alliance of democracies. But the conclusion would be, if push comes to shove, geopolitics always trumps values. So geopolitics prevails if necessary. Next slide, please. Looking from the perspective of small states in a polarized world have two options. They have only basically two options. One option is to bandwagon with a great power and join one of those alliances with the leading great power, or they can stay neutral to avoid an entanglement in a potential great power conflict. So realists also would add a third option. They would say balancing is the choice, but balancing is not a choice for small states. Small states do not make much of a difference in balancing. And if they call what they're doing balancing, it's not so much balancing, it's more a euphemism for bandwagoning anyway. So joining a big, jump on the bandwagon of a big state of a great power. European citizens are aware of this potential danger to be entangled. So there was a survey last year in early summer was this survey, and the Europeans were asked what would they want to do if it comes to a great power conflict between China and the US. And the question was, did not include, not even include military conflict. It only said conflict. Still, 60% to 60% of the Europeans would say they would rather stay neutral and not side with one of the big powers. Of course, they would not side with China, but they did not want to be involved in a great power conflict with the US either, because they thought that it's not our conflict. So that was an interesting for me. Coming from a neutral state, it was interesting for me to see this. Looking, so because we have this current debate now about Ukraine, looking at the states now in between Russia and NATO, because now we have this conflict between Russia and the US, this in between states. So there are those who are not part of the Russian sphere of influence and not a member of NATO. The expression was used by the report back to diplomacy by the OSCE, the so-called issuing a report of 2015. It was not invented because the expression was coined by George Kennan in 1956. It was interesting because he looked at the Austrian model of neutrality and said, why not apply it to all to Central Europe and to Germany to get the German unification? So a neutral zone that included Germany, Austria, Poland, Czechoslovakia, and Hungary. Others made similar suggestions. Of course, it did not work out, as we know. And Germany remained divided, and there was no, and the other states except Austria were integrated in the eastern in the eastern blocs. Now we have a very similar situation. In some of these states are Russian troops deployed or Russian supported militias, like in Ukraine and Georgia. And there might be the possibility that basically they have two choices now, these states. So they have the possibility, choice one, bandwagoning with a great power and joining an alliance. So we see it in the case of Ukraine. So they might want to join NATO. But then there would be the fate of Germany. So they would remain divided because Russian troops and militias and Russian troops would remain in the Donbas region, and what Russia, probably that's what I'm guessing here now, what Russia now is doing is if Ukraine stays on NATO course, so it will occupy Donbas. So then we have a situation like East and West Germany in the 50s. And the second choice, what these states have, is they go neutral, like Austria did, and Austria was occupied and entangled in great power conflict. But when Austria became neutral, it got its territorial integrity and sovereignty back and avoided permanent division and permanent occupation. So there is a choice for these in-between states between permanent neutrality and permanent division. Another, just built on this idea of George Kennan of this zone, of course it would be an interesting experiment to create a neutral zone which includes these in-between states, Belarus, Ukraine, Moldova, and of course territorially disconnected Georgia as well. And it could be linked to a nuclear weapon-free zone like Rapatsky suggested in 57 as well. Yes, so in my newsletter, I added this neutral nuclear weapon-free zone as well as a point. Next slide, please. So, of course, what do we do with this big power confrontation? Look back in history as well. So the best document which addressed this confrontation was the Helsinki document of 1975. Now it's used very selectively, but we have to look at the whole document, this final act. So if you read it carefully, it does not use expressions like enemy, rival, adversary, competitor. If you look at today's security and defense strategies of the great powers, it's full of these expressions. It's full of these expressions. So the Helsinki Final Act did not use them, but they talked about cooperative security, common security. Security is indivisible. And they also added the Decalogue of Values. Surprisingly, the Soviet Union accepted this, which are not really human rights, but it's the humanitarian values. A limited freedom of press is addressed. So that's what, because the Soviet Union was satisfied that their sphere of influence at that time was recognized, so it would accept this Decalogue of Values as well. There was also this, the border, so looking at the what Russia did with the Ukraine, so illegally, with Ukraine saying and with the Crimea, illegally occupied it, it would have been possible to negotiate some border changes as well in the framework of the Helsinki document, because it would allow border changes, but based on consensus and on international law. Of course, that's what the Germans wanted at that time, because they were thinking already, of course, of German unification. Preceding the Helsinki process, and Helsinki process is an institutional process which went on and ended up at the OSCE, what we have today, but that's the core here. Preceding was this Hamel plan of 67, and it called for a strong deterrence, but also dialogue. That's what we hear today. Today we bring a strong defense, deterrence, and dialogue. We are not at Helsinki. We don't have these principles and norms and rules of Helsinki. When it comes really, if in the situation of the Cold War, so we are at the Hamel Plan 67 or even before that. So what should we aim for? Next aim should be 1975. So that should we try to reach for the next step in order to avoid great power conflict. So I think I'm right in the time. Thank you.